Splendor Audiobooks presents this unabridged recording of Five Rings Circus, written by Jon Cleary and read by David Tredinnick. The book begins with a dedication for Joy. Author's note. In the first half of 1996, a five-line item appeared in a Sydney newspaper. Two Chinese students were being questioned about the deposit in their bank accounts of some $50 million. The story was not followed up, and no more was heard of the students and their sudden fortune. This book is not a guess at what may have been behind that meager story. It is fiction, and none of the characters is meant to represent anyone, living or dead. Anyone who sees himself or herself here has looked in the wrong mirror. Chapter 1. A working mum, said Tom. I can't get used to the idea.
I've been a working mum ever since I started having you lot, said Lisa.
Watch yourself, or you'll be paying for your own dinner.
Oh, that'll please old fishhooks in the pockets,
said Maureen, patting her father's arm.
Would you like me and Claire to go Dutch?
Speak for yourself, said Claire.
I'm being extravagant at his expense tonight. Do Chinese restaurants serve French champagne?
If it does, said Malone, I'll have it closed down for extortion. He had the benign look that husbands and fathers occasionally achieve when the stars are in their right places in the heavens. Tonight was such an occasion. The family was celebrating Lisa's first month back in the workforce after 21 years, an event the children seemed to equate with the introduction of suffragism. He still thought of them as the children, or usually the kids, but they were kids no longer, and he was only slowly coming to terms with the changes in them. Claire was 21 and in her third year of law at Sydney University. Coolly beautiful and with her eyes wide open for the traps that the world and its men might lay for her. Maureen was almost 19 and doing communications at New South Wales. Dark, where her sister was blonde, willing to risk the world and its men. Tom was 17 and only a year away from university and 2 years into girls. Malone trusted their independent outlook. He was still coming to terms with Lisa's stated desire for her own independence. The Golden Gate was not the largest restaurant in Sydney's Chinatown, but it was the ritziest. Dim sum and chop suey were unmentionables here. It had a huge chandelier that, it was claimed, had hung in the palace of the Empress Cixi, a lady not known for welcoming foreign guests, gourmets or otherwise. The carpet, it was also claimed, had been woven by the nimble fingers of 300 small boys working day and night in a village in Xinjiang. There was also a claim, spread by restaurant competitors, that the Chinese characters in one corner of the carpet translated as Axminster. Pale green linen covered the tables clustered in the middle of the big room, and red velvet-covered banquettes lined the walls, which were in turn covered in green shantung. The waiters, no coolies here, were mandarins in training, and tips were encouraged to be in ransom terms. On the floor above the restaurant were private dining rooms. The third floor, supposedly the manager's residence, was given over to four gambling rooms that had never known the indignity of a police raid. The Golden Gate was a compulsory pit stop for all visiting delegations from Communist China, both in the restaurant and the gambling rooms. It had, among all its other claims, class. Something that all who came here, including the communists, appreciated.
"Do you make as much money as Dad?"
asked Tom, who was doing economics in Year 12.
"He doesn't want to know," said Lisa.
"And neither should you."
"Right on," said Maureen, and Claire nodded in agreement. Tom abruptly looked uncomfortable. He was a big lad, as tall as his father at 6'1", and already starting to bulk out in chest and shoulders. Like his sisters, he had inherited his mother's good looks, though there were hints of his father in them. He had not inherited his mother's cool composure, and emotion showed on his face in bold relief.
Sorry, I didn't mean...
Lisa, sitting next to him in the banquette, patted his hand.
It's all right. It's just that the money's not important. What are you grinning at?
Was I grinning? Said Malone. I thought I was looking pained.
Come on, said Claire. Let's order before he starts chewing on his American Express card.
Malone didn't mind the shyacking. He couldn't be in a better mood. It had been a quiet week in Sydney for murder. Only three, all domestics that had been attended to by local detectives. There had been no call on homicide and serial offenders unit. There had been appearances in court to give evidence at murder trials. Other detectives had been at work on task forces looking into homicides still unsolved. And for Malone, the coordinator in charge of homicide, there had been the opportunity to catch up on the hated paperwork. This Friday night family dinner was a pleasant end of the week. Then a tall, handsome Chinese got up from a banquette at the rear of the restaurant and came towards them.
Inspector Malone, it is a pleasure to see you here. A family celebration?
Sort of. How are you, Liz? You've met my wife, and these are... He introduced Claire, Maureen and Tom, feeling some of the pride that, a modest man, he occasionally lets seep out of him. Mr. Chung, he's one of the owners. Leslie Chung had come to Australia 40 years ago, when he was still in his teens. He had walked out of the hills of Yunnan and down to Hong Kong, arriving there just as that city was getting into its stride as a place to coin money. After a couple of months there, he had decided there was already too much competition for an ambitious capitalist, especially a teenage, penniless one. He had got a job as a deckhand on a freighter plying between Hong Kong and Sydney. On its second trip, he had deserted in Sydney, convinced even then that the locals could never match wits with him. His English was negligible, so he took a job as a kitchen hand in a restaurant in Chinatown, changed his name, and started saving his money. He won money in the various gambling dens that could be found in every section of Chinatown in those days. He was a careful gambler and a careful saver. He studied English, accountancy, and the natives' talent for never taking the long view. He had been born with the long view. He had been poor, but not uneducated in his country's long history. He was never burdened by scruples, since he also learned that a lack of those qualities didn't necessarily hold one back in local business and political circles. He prospered slowly but gradually, not always within the law, but the authorities never troubled him. Those who tried went away suitably recompensed for their trouble. He had progressed far enough up the social scale to recognise barbarians when he saw them. Unlike the majority of his fellow expatriates, he had severed all ties with his family in Yunnan. He set about building his own family. He married the daughter of one of Chinatown's most respected businessmen, now had two daughters, both recent graduates in law and medicine, respectively. He had a large house in Bellevue Hill, a conservative eastern suburb. He gave handsomely to charity, so long as there was a tax rebate, and, since Sydney was now an ethnically correct city, he was on all official invitation lists. It was just a pity that he had no scruples. Malone knew about the lack of scruples, but he knew very little else about Les Chung.
Business is good.
Enough to keep the wolf from the door.
Chung looked around the crowded room, then back at Malone and smiled. His sense of humour was not as robust as that of the natives. It was drier, more sardonic, much like that of the natives of 40 years ago, when he had arrived here. Much like Malone's.
Business is good with you.
Malone, too, smiled. Part of the pleasure of meeting Crims was that occasionally you met one whom you had to like, even if you didn't admire him. Les Chung had never been on a police docket, but the police knew, if no one else did, that he consorted with criminals. The difference between him and them was that he was civilized, a quality Malone always respected.
The less business we have, the better,
Well, enjoy your dinner. I'll have them bring you some champagne with my compliments.
Malone was about to say no, but Claire was too quick for him.
Thank you, Mr. Chung. Mum was brought up on champagne.
Well, then I'll have them bring you the best, Mrs. Malone.
He looked towards the rear of the restaurant, then abruptly sat down, pushing Tom further into the banquette.
Move over! Quick! Move over, boy!
Malone, sitting opposite him, looked past him towards the rear of the restaurant. A man in a dark suit, wearing a stocking mask, had come in through the kitchen door. He was carrying a gun. He stopped by the last banquette where three Chinese men were dining. He fired 6 shots, unheard in the clatter and chatter of the big room. Then he turned and, unhurried, went out through the kitchen door, which swung shut behind him. The killing had taken no more than 5 or 6 seconds.
I have no idea who that man was.
That wasn't what I asked you, Liz. I asked you if you knew who had sent him.
No.
There had been no immediate panic after the shooting. Those people in the banquette next to the last and those at the nearby tables had seemed at first not to have taken in what had happened. Then the bloodied head slumped forward into the food on the banquette's table had abruptly conjured up horror. One man's hand had convulsed for a moment, like a bird trying to take off, then was still, chopsticks slipping out of it like skeletal fingers. Then suddenly panic had set in and, like the starting up of a washing machine, turmoil had spun through the restaurant. Screams and shouts shut out the clatter and chatter. Chairs were overturned. Even a table was sent crashing. Malone had snapped at Lisa and the children to stay where they were, jumped to his feet and headed for the kitchen. He paused for a moment at the rear banquette, saw at once that the three Chinese men were dead. The booth was a bloody mess. Behind him, a woman screamed, as if she had only just realised that the men were indeed dead. He went on into the kitchen. He was not carrying a gun. This was a night out. He was in the kitchen, glimpsed the terrified faces of the staff, before he realised he could do nothing if the gunman was not already gone. A miasma of steam hung above the stoves. A huge wok of noodles hissed like a pit of snakes. Kitchen staff and waiters stared at him as if he, too, might be a gunman. He flashed his badge.
Police! Where is he?
For a moment, nobody moved. Then a chef jerked his head towards the rear and gasped,
Gone! Through back door!
You all okay?
He tried to look concerned, but all he was doing was giving the masked man time to get away. Dead cops never caught killers. He was not a coward, just a cautious hero. He always insisted that his detectives worked on the same principle. The kitchen staff looked at each other, then nodded. They were all Asian. Chinese, Vietnamese, Cambodian. He wouldn't have known the difference till he heard their names. And suddenly they all looked inscrutable. Sweat shone on their bland faces like water on a row of plates. They were going to tell him nothing. He passed down the narrow aisle between the stoves, pushed open the back door and peered out. He was looking at an alley only wide enough for a car or small truck to back up or down it. A slice of moon hung at one end of the alley, skew whiff in the sky like a badly hung ornament. Faintly, there came the sound of a rock band trying to blow the roof off the nearby entertainment centre. A cat snarled somewhere amongst the rubbish bins and cartons along the walls of the alley, but otherwise the narrow lane was empty. He pushed the door wider and stepped out. Stood a moment, feeling a mixture of relief and frustration. It was a mixture he had experienced many times before. He took a deep breath, then went back inside to begin work. He saw a phone on the kitchen wall, took off the receiver and dialed 000.
This is Inspector Malone from Homicide. There's been a shooting in the Golden Gate in Dixon Street. 3 bodies. Get the necessary down here quick. Police as well as ambulances and the pathology guy.
He hung up. Turned back to the staff, most of whom had already removed their aprons. No customers would be doing any more ordering. What was the point of staying? The Golden Gate didn't pay overtime nor give time off in lieu.
Nobody leaves. Understand?
But he was on his own. He knew as soon as his back was turned, they would be gone. He looked at the head chef.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.